part of our representation from the Diocese of Olympia. And for those of you who haven't necessarily been in our Episcopal 101 class, a quick reminder, General Convention meets only once every 3 years. Our church in the United States and our affiliates of the Episcopal Church, those who are full membership with us in other countries, we are not governed by bishops. We are not governed by our presiding bishop, Catherine Shepherd Story. Rather, the Episcopal Church is governed by a General Convention. General Convention takes on a bicameral nature in terms of how we legislate our governance. So by bicameral, we have two houses, and in order for a resolution to be passed as a canon, we need to have it approved in both the House of Bishops and in the House of Deputies. The House of Bishops is composed of all our bishops, including those who are retired, and our House of Deputies is composed of equal numbers of clergy and lay, who are elected in their respective dioceses. Each diocese gets to send 4 lay and 4 clergy. Ours were elected at our diocesan convention the year before General Convention. So I was honored to be a clergy delegate representative to our folks. Now, what was interesting is because I was first an alternate, it meant that when one of the other 4 clergy needed a break, or they couldn't be at a 4 session, I would fill in for them. But I was in the most desirable position because it also meant that I had time when the House of Deputies was meeting to go and listen to what was going on in the House of Bishops. That's fascinating. That's fascinating. And it's a little bit like, we did things a little differently because there's a lot fewer bishops. There's about 300 bishops, and there's about 800 and plus delegates. Plus, visitors from other parts of the Anglican Communion, as well as from Province 9, which is composed of places like Ecuador and others. So having all these representatives there and people in purple shirts, right? You're running into purple people everywhere you go. It was a whole experience in itself. There's a committee process. Each committee of the church that has specific kinds of responsibilities creates resolutions specific to what it represents. There are open hearing sessions that people can attend, the bishops and deputies, to be able to hear on specific issues and be able to also do input. You can go to a committee in legislation, but you can't say anything. And if you do, you're invited to leave. Because you can observe the committee, and then there are hearings in which you can put in your 2 cents. Everything is strictly regulated by time. So if you have something to say, you better say it quickly because you only have 2 minutes in the committee. Then, everything finally, the resolutions are created, including the budget, and goes in front of both houses, and you have to approve each. Sometimes what would happen is the House of Bishops would say, we approve this, and the House of Deputies would say, we don't. So when that happens, things go back to committee, and we may see them in the next triennium, the next time we meet as a general convention. So this general convention, having told you that we have this in there, this general convention, I'm told by people who attend them regularly, who are elected often, and the bishops, said that they felt that this general convention had a particularly amazing spirit to it, that people were truly in deep relationship with one another, whether you consider yourself very progressive or conservative, that there was a great sense of dialogue and commitment to one another. And that was, I think, proven in both the House of Bishops and the House of Deputies. We did many, many things together that I want to share a little bit of the taste with you about. Because now that we've passed them into canon law or into our ways of working as a church, you need to know about them. One of the things that we did pass in both houses was a commitment to divest from fossil fuels. The only fund that will not apply to is the Episcopal Church's pension fund, which makes sure that our retired clergy can draw from pension. That may happen in time, and I think that's the intention, but that will take a lot more time. It's just a triennial. So, but everything else is being encouraged to divest from fossil fuels. So I think we have a number of our bishops coming into the environment. We'll be very happy about that. So you're there. What that means for us is Trinity does have investment in endowment funds of our own. And so our vestry and our endowment committee over the next 3 years, we'll be taking a look at what we might want to do about that, because that will impact our choices. And there's some several good guidelines that we can refer to. We're not going to have to do that on our own. We also, though, however, did not pass in both houses a resolution to come before us to divest from certain trade with Israel as a protest against what's happening with Israel Palestine. The reason that happened, before you think that, oh my gosh, how could we not do that? Yeah. The reason that happened, first of all, is the relationships there are extraordinarily complex. But Archbishop Salil Dawani, who is the Archbishop of Jerusalem and also provides Anglican oversight to Syria and Lebanon, he asked our House of Bishops to not agree to do that. And one of the most biggest reasons for that is because when stuff happens like that, that kind of jostles up the Arab world relationship with Israel, it impacts him and the ability of his priests to do effective ministry in Israel and in Syria and in Lebanon. And they have, the government of Israel has inhibited his ability to travel when things like that happen. So he asked us not to throw our hat into the ring on that one, because he really does need the relationship with the Church in the United States and our affiliates, our other full pieces of the Episcopal Church. The things that we passed that had to do with structural changes all came out of a special task force that's now complete and expanded called TREC, or the Task Force for Reimagining the Episcopal Church, in terms of trying to reduce our top-loaded heavy structure and make us a little bit more nimble for the future. And so one of the biggest pieces of that is we have several committees, councils, advisory bodies, and boards. They're called CCAEs. And we have 14. We have reduced ourselves to 2 standing committees. 2. Now, you can imagine those 2. The first is our committee as a standing committee for structure, governance, constitution, and canon. We can never be without that. We can have to say that. So that continues, as does liturgy and music, because we are a liturgical church, and that's always an ongoing developmental process, right? So it doesn't mean that the executive council, which is kind of responsible for making sure that in general that convention passes, resolves, that those will actually happen. That's what the executive council of the Episcopal Church is responsible to make sure of. So if they needed to appoint a specific task force during a triennium, do a piece of work, they will do that. But then at the end of the triennium, that's gone, unless the executive council decides that it needs to continue for another triennium. So that will actually keep us more nimble in that way. We also gave some additional executive powers to executive council, including the ability to help the presiding bishop select our 3 top officers, our chief operating officer, our chief financial officer, and our legal representative. So that means that the person who heads the House of Deputies will be working closely with the presiding bishop on those, as well as executive council together. We passed legislation that basically made a statement against gun violence and to encourage our state and national legislatures to enact laws in order to do better background checks on firearms. So that is something that this church has committed itself to, is taking proactive political stand on gun regulation. So be aware of that. When you hear me talk about it, instead of getting mad or frustrated, if you are, because this is something that NRA also is committed to, and one of the sponsors of this resolve that we passed is an active member of NRA, and said we want responsible gun ownership and background checks. So that's why that's happened. We also passed some things related to our prayer book. So are you ready for this? Mm-hmm. Most people think that we just have the Book of Common Prayer, and that's the only source that we've got. But over the last few triennia, encouraging our worship that we passed a while ago. We can use things from that. Every once in a while, this 10 o'clock service gets a little bit of that during certain seasons of the year. They also passed permission to use, they're creating a new resource called Cloud of Witnesses. That's going to be in addition to what we already created, which is called Holy Women, Holy Men. And those two resources, like Holy Women, Holy Men, provide reflections for daily offices on other kinds of important people who are not necessarily always Christian people. For example, the three chaplains who in the Navy who gave over their life vests, one of those was Jewish. We include that trio into our recognition in daily offices, people remember as important people. We also gave permission for what's called a right-free service to be used as a normal or primary Sunday service. Now, for those of you who like to flip through your book on prayer, you'll see there's a right one, that's the one that we do at 8 o'clock here. There's a right two, that's what you're all in right now. And right three just provides an outline for what you can do in the order in which you need to do it, but there's no text. And so how that's been used before is that clergy could not use it on a Sunday, but on other special services, they would have to write in permission and ask permission to do that. Now, they can create a service, write into the bishop to do it, and with the bishop's permission, use it as a primary Sunday service. That's really important in places like our mission service areas that need to be able to create liturgies that are appropriate for the culture and context of their specific community. And there may be times, there may be a reason that we want to say together as a community that we would want to do that for a special occasion or some other thing. We also can use a source, you'll love this, some of you will love this, some of you will, there's a source that's been approved that we can also use for prayers and services called All Desires Known by an author called Janet Morley. For those of you who may not know of Janet Morley, she writes beautiful prayers very much along the line of Julian of Norwich, in which there's a lot of feminine imagery for Christ and for God. Now, hear me say feminine, not feminist, no hope not, right? People who hear that word, feminine images of God and language that is very inclusive in the service. So we are now canonically allowed to use those prayers and materials. Another thing that we passed was a commitment through in our budget for lots of things, but one of these specifically was for enhancing our church's ability, religious worker ability, to communicate out to young adults and youth through digital communication, using all these tools to do church. And there's a lot of money backing that up to help train clergy and others who may not have been raised on using iPads from day one to learn how to do that. In fact, during a whole general convention, there was no paper. We used an iPad that had been programmed with all the documents that we needed, including for worship that we have every day, and the results that we were looking at, and information that we had to have. And it got me so excited with the idea of converting at some point for us to use that, how much paper we would save, and having so much more, including the whole Book of Common Prayer, if you wanted it, on a little tablet that you hold. So just know that I'm thinking about that, and I'm interested to know if anybody else is interested in thinking about that, and work on a team with me to do a study around that for ourselves. So, very exciting stuff there. We also had an amazing spirit going on around some of the resolutions that were very social justice oriented. We passed a resolution to basically make statements against reprehensible conditions in prisons, both domestic and foreign. We made a resolution to encourage our national government to recognize citizenship based on where a person is born. We passed a resolution that was taking a stance against the way that Haitians are being expulsed from their own country in a sort of action, sort of genocide behavior. We took a resolution against the persecution of lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender people in Uganda. We passed a resolution asking the church each church parish to look at how we needed to create opportunities for differently abled people to have access to our events. And I know there's some of you out there who know that we plan to get an elevator, and I'm planning to fold that into a larger plan to renovate Rogers Hall. We also passed a resolution to look at what we think about communion. We're going to do a study on how we think about who has access to communion. So we're going to look at that. Now, the biggest things that the press really got a hold of and was a big deal had to do with passing some changes in our prayer book, adding four new rites related to marriage. Two of those rites are for blessing. If you think about it, people may have had a civil ceremony, may later in life decide they want to get blessed in the church. So they don't need to be married again, they just get a blessing. So there's two rites of blessing and two rites of marriage. All four of these rites have inclusive language and can be used for any gender couple. And that's intentional because we also passed a resolution to change the law or canon of our church and the language in that canon that talks about marriage from a language that talks only about the men and the women to all peoples and all couples, such that we will no longer have a separate rite called covenant union for same-gender couples, but now all couples and all rites of marriage will be referred to as marriage. One of the reasons that's important is because the visible church has provided a prophetic voice, much like what we've read in the first two readings and in the gospel. The Episcopal Church has been a prophetic voice in the Anglican Communion and in the world for some time. The marriage resolutions of these changes I just mentioned didn't just suddenly happen because we were excited by the Supreme Court. Legislators, there were deputies who got up to provide testimony as we were debating these resolutions, and one of them talked about how when he began to try to work with LGBTQ advocacy in the Episcopal Church, it was 40 years ago. 40 years ago, back in the 70s, when people started to ask for changes in the church for greater inclusion. And he said when he started that work in the church, he wasn't married, didn't have any kids, but it's taken long enough to get to this point that he now has 3 children and 7 grandchildren. He said, this is taking generations to make happen. This didn't suddenly happen because we got on the bandwagon. We were already driving the wagon, and the rest of our country got on board with us. So know that when people say to you, oh, you belong to a church that's just, you know, going with the populist whims and you're under pressure. We've been putting on the pressure. We had a Eucharist one evening that was called the Integrity Eucharist. Integrity is an Episcopal organization that was founded by one of our gay lay people called Louis Crew and his partner at that time, now they're married, had gone to church for the first time at Grace Cathedral in San Francisco. And when they walked in, they asked if they could network, back in the 70s this was, with other gay Episcopalians, and they were looked at like, what? You want to network with who? And this was in San Francisco. So he created Integrity as an Episcopal organization of advocacy for gay Episcopalians and transgender. And people questioned. At a time before that was something anybody even wanted to talk about at all. And during that Eucharist that night, we honored Louis Crew together with her and his husband. And heard from a powerful sermon from Mary Glasspool, who was our first openly gay female bishop in the Episcopal Church. Now, a lot of people get uncomfortable, a little squirmy when we talk about these things, but this is part of the role of the church that we have right now, even within the communion. It was the first time that the Integrity Eucharistic Convention had been held the same open space that all the other worship services of general convention was held. In the past, in 30 years, we hold off on our campuses off-site, but this time was right in the middle of our work and right in the middle of our prayer and church life. It took 40 years to get there, but we can be proud that we are there. Now, our prophetic voice in the Anglican communion is not comfortable for everyone, but I want you to know that in those years that we have been doing this work, that our House of Bishops have been working hard together, especially since 2003, with the consecration of Gene Robinson. Mm-hmm. Our House of Bishops has been working diligently to basically be much more authentic and real and develop their relationships with one another as bishops in this diocese. In the recognition that this is not easy work to do and not everyone agrees. This convention, I think, has such a spirit about it because of the hard work of our bishops on their relationships with one another. And it really did model our relationships as dioceses in debate within the House of Deputies. And you could tell that even though the people who were saying, I'm not going to vote for this, but I appreciate how we had the conversation, because there was a minority report of the dissenting bishops that they wrote that basically said, we appreciate that you are valuing the relationship and we feel that you are really valuing our voice and that you have made the legislation in such a way that bishops who don't agree can say to their clergy, we're not going to do these rites in my diocese, but the legislation also says that even bishops who do not agree will create a mechanism by which couples seeking to use these rites can use them by going to an adjacent diocese so they will establish a liaison relationship with them. And even if they say clergy can't use them, the legislation says clergy can't get in trouble if they do. So you hear how this is working, and the fact that it passed both houses, people are saying, we get that this is happening, but we get a need for ongoing respect and continued dialogue, but this is what we're choosing to do together. And then, of course, the most exciting thing for lots and lots of people is that we elected, as our next presiding bishop, Michael Curry of North Carolina. Michael Curry is our first Black presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church. And he will be vested at a service at the Washington National Cathedral in November. It was very clear both in our budget and in resolutions that we passed, and the fact that Bishop Curry was elected in the House of Bishops, because that's who does it, on the first ballot. And out of 800 plus, or I should say 300 plus in the House of Bishops, there were only less than 40 bishops voting for somebody else. So it was very clear, again, that the bishops are leading us and showing us that they recognize we are going to be working on issues of evangelism and racism, anti-racism, in our church in a very intentional way. And we've been funded to do anti-racism initiatives through our budget in this triennium. He brings a spirit of evangelism that I think Episcopalians who can consider themselves extremely Catholic and liturgical would be very comfortable with. He has a way of energizing people in his preaching and of being that prophet. A theme that was resonating throughout the entire time together, in addition to marriage equality, was that Black lives matter. There were posters about that. There were services about that. There were the body of union of Black Episcopalians was more jubilant than you can ever imagine. Perhaps much like the women were last time when Captain Jeffrey Shorey was elected as presiding bishop. And that kind of joy is the kind of joy that we should want for one another. In our ethnic ministries, our young adults were exemplary in how they dealt even with racism that they were experiencing at convention. That the Episcopal Church needs to continue seeing you in a very intentional way of addressing how can we, how must we support the diversity that we need to raise into leadership, into the church, so that all people feel genuinely encouraged into the body of Christ. Jesus went to his own hometown to preach this kind of inclusion, this kind of need of transformation, and then God was doing a new thing. But his own house did not appreciate what he was doing and saying, because they knew him. In the same way, I think the Anglican Communion looks at the Episcopal Church and says, what are you doing? You're irritating some of us who are not there yet in the Global South and in England to be able to appreciate what you're doing. But I tell you, there are unchurched people in our country and around the world who have read the newspapers in this past week and have said, hallelujah. Even if they were not religious, the idea that a Christian tradition which has spent generations and even centuries persecuting minorities and gay people has stood up with a prophetic voice and said, not only are we not doing that anymore,